We now have a good understanding of what the ST-SRAM bit cell looks like, how it operates, and a bit about its layout. Let's now move over to the stability, because remember, we're going to have millions of these on a chip, and we want to make sure that they actually all work. So again, we have here our cross-coupled inverter pair, as you can see in the picture down below, and we want to make sure that it actually works. The basic definition of what is known as static noise margin is to take two noise voltage sources. These are static voltage sources. They're each with some size Vn, and see what is the size of this Vn voltage source that will flip the cell. Now notice that they're in opposite directions. They're both from minus to plus over here, but that operates oppositely on both sides. So if we had a zero here, this becomes Vn, and if we had a one here, this becomes VDD minus Vn. And the question is, what is the point at which our cell flips? What is the size of this voltage source? So there's been a bunch of work by Sievink and Lostro way back at the late 70s, early 80s, where they looked a lot at this static noise margin, and they proved that static noise margin has many equivalents to that first definition that I showed before. And one of them is what we use, the butterfly curves. So we take the two inverters over here, the cross-coupled inverters. This one is from QB to Q, and this is from Q to QB. And we plot their VTCs on the same plot as we did earlier when we were showing how the SRAM cell is bistability. And a equivalent definition to what we saw before is that the static noise margin is the size, the edge size of the square, the largest square that fits inside these butterfly curves. Okay, so how are we going to get this? We are going to plot the VTCs, the voltage transfer curves, of both of the inverters on the same graph, as you can see here. And then we're going to find this maximum square that fits into the VTC. Now there's going to be one for this area, which could be called, I guess, the zero. And this is for the one area. So we're going to have another one over here, and we're going to take the minimum of the static noise margin of these two guys. Okay, so the side of the square, which is the minimum of the maximum square that fits into the lobes of the butterfly curves. Well, the question now is, what happens during read? We can't actually ignore the access transistors anymore. Now we have the M2 and M5 are both going to be on. And if they're on, we get the equivalent circuits that are shown below. Now, beforehand, if we looked at one of the previous parts of our analysis, we just assumed that the Q in QB were at a constant voltage, and so forth. Now we shut off some of the transistors over here and erase them from our equivalent schematic. But when trying to draw to plot a VTC of these inverters, what we actually have to do is run the input voltage, which in this case will be QB for this inverter, and for this inverter it'll be Q, from zero to VDD, and we cannot just turn off some of the transistors in that situation. So what we have here is, this is our input voltage over here, and this is our output voltage, but we do have M2, our access transistor, is now going to be always on because its gate is at VDD constant, and it's we're going to assume that its source is, actually drain in this case, is also going to be constant. And what we get here actually when we take QB and run it from zero to VDD, or Q and run it from zero to VDD and put that as our input voltage, what we're going to have is that when we are at the zero state, so if QB here or Q is equal to zero, M4 is going to be off, and we're going to easily drive QB up to VDD, and that's what we're going to get, our maximum VDD output voltage. So this would be VDD. At some point, M4 is going to turn on over here, right? So it's going to turn on, and it's going to start fighting with M6 and M5, which are driving the voltage up, and that's why we're going to have this drop. Of course, once we get to VDD over here at Q, which is this point over here at VDD, this is going to be off, and then we're going to have some sort of a delta V over here, which is the fight between M5 and M4, and that's going to be this non-rail-to-rail swing. So our VTC is going to look something like this. So it's going to be the same for both sides, because remember, it's completely symmetric. We pre-charge both sides to VDD, and now we're going to be, for the VTCs, we're running the internal nodes, the Q and the QB, from 0 to VDD. So the point is that it's completely symmetric with M1, M2, and M3, and M4, M5, and M6. But Again, since they're cross-coupled, we can flip them over and put them on the same graph, and we get butterfly curves. The difference is that instead of going all the way down to here and all the way down to here, we have these depleted curves, as you can see with the blue here. And so this is going to be the read SNM. It's the biggest square that we can put inside the lobes. And what we can see, this is going to be a smaller square. The read SNM over here is going to be a smaller square than the standard hold SNM. So, and that makes sense. When we're reading, we saw that we already have some noise that appears on the zero side of the storage. So we're going to have some delta V over there. And that means that we're more susceptible to noise. A smaller noise jolt is going to flip our cell. How about write? So now the two sides are different, actually. It's not symmetric anymore. We have one side, as we saw before, it's the same exact picture as before. So we get this VTC that has this kind of NMOS type VTC where it doesn't get down to a full rail-to-rail swing. That's on one side. But what happens with this write type of thing? This is very strange, actually. So let's try to figure it out. Well, if we have Q equals VDD, so then M6 is off, and M4 and M5 are both pulling down to ground, and so we get a clean zero at the output. But what actually happens when we have zero at Q? So when Q is zero, then M6 is on, okay, and M4 is off, right? But M5 is still on. So we get here something that's a fight between M4 and M5, and it should be something like VDD over 2, okay? And we're gonna have some continuous line between them. This is not a good digital gate. It's a real ugly digital gate, actually. And if we look at it, it's gonna be something like this. So when we have Q equals VDD, we're gonna have zero over here. But when Q equals zero, we're gonna have something that's small, maybe something closer to VDD over two. So this is our type of a VTC. That is not a digital gate, it's a real ugly thing. But still, that's the way it looks like. Well, we can take these two things as before and we can plot them on the same plot. So when we flip over our feedback, weird type of VTC here of the right, we get this type of ugly thing, and this is our NMOS type of a VTC for the one side, okay? And what we see here is something strange. Do you see any places where these two lines cross? And just looking at it for a second, yes, we do. We see this place over here where they cross, where at this point, if this is Q and this is QB, that means Q equals VDD and QB equals zero, which we called a one. And that's interesting because it's the only place where these cross. This is not a bistable circuit. It's a monostable circuit. And that's a good thing. Remember, we are writing to the cell. We want to change the cell's content and bring it to a pre-known state that we're driving it to. This can only be stable at this state of one. So we are writing a one here successfully because we took the bistable circuit, we broke the bistability, and turned it into a monostable circuit, which can only be settle at one. And that's a good thing. So what exactly is the static noise margin? Well, it's noise that would hit this cell and actually cause it to remain bistable, cause us to have some sort of a crossing point on this side of the graph. So the largest square that we can fit in on the right side of the graph over here, which represents the noise source that would actually connect these two graphs, so we would continue to have a stable point on the right side, that would ruin our ability to write to the cell. So that is defined as the classic write at SNM type of a thing. So if there's a stable point over here, the wrong data is written. However, write SNM is kind of crazy. It depends on the cell separatrix, which we'll discuss in a little bit. And so therefore, alternative definitions have been proposed. It's a strange type of a definition. People don't like it too much. Sometimes they don't like the read SNM either, mainly because these, remember, are dynamic type of operations, and we're trying to describe them with a static type of a definition. Okay, so one of the things is a bitline sweep, and how would we do this? We would add a DC voltage to the zero bitline and see how high it can be to still flip the cell. Okay, so again, we have our so just assume that this was our cross-coupled inverter over here. Okay, and we had a one over here, and we had a zero over here, and we are writing now to the cell. Okay, I guess let's do it opposite way. Okay, so we have a one over here and a zero over here, and this is going to be at zero. I just did this opposite again. Well, and this is going to be at one. Okay, what we're saying here is we're going to add some sort of a voltage here. It's going to be size VBL. And if it's zero, we're going to be able to write down here. But if obviously this was one, it's a read situation, and we're not going to be able to write over here. So we're going to raise VBL as much as possible, as you can see here, until we cannot write to the cell anymore. So that's an alternative definition. That's a bitline sweep definition. And there are different definitions that you can use and see how to define write SNM. The main thing about all these definitions is that when you compare things, you have to compare apples to apples and use the same definition for all of your cells. So with this VBL type of sweep, what we would have is when VBL is zero, that's the standard graph that we expect to see over here. When VBL equals one, we're in a read situation, so we get this. And there are many different definitions on the way, many different VTCs are on the way, and at some point we'll have one that these guys will touch each other, and then that is where our write will not succeed, and so that is our write noise margin in this case. Another point to discuss is what's called dynamic stability. So up till now we've been discussing static noise margins, right? S and M. And what are static noise margins? They have the word static inside. But is noise a static phenomenon? I mean, if you take our cross-coupled inverters, right, and we said that we stick some sort of voltage source here on both of these nodes, what could cause a constant voltage to be on both of the nodes? In fact, I believe this is not even a physical operation. What can cause noise? Maybe if we had cross-coupling to some sort of other type of a pulse that was going over here, it could cause some sort of noise pulse inside one of these internal nodes. Or maybe we have, like on our VDD here, we would have some sort of voltage droop. That's a type of a noise that you would typically find inside a type of an SRAM. But both of these things are dynamic operations. They're not static operations. And furthermore, when we talk about reading and writing, these are dynamic operations. And the actual state of the circuit changes throughout these things. And we assume that they were static, put constant voltages and so forth inside our cell. So this is a very strange type of thing that we're relating to very dynamic operations with a static definition. And the reason is because it's easy. It gives us a nice one number solution that we can thereafter go and check variation and so forth. If we wanted to really check what's going on or simulate what's going on, what would be much better is, for example, to stick a current source that would go and cause some sort of a waveform of noise to go and affect an internal node. The problem is that this type of a waveform, it has a shape. It has a shape that has, at the very least, a duration and a magnitude. Right? It has at least duration and magnitude. So that's at least two parameters. It probably also has a shape. So it wouldn't just be a duration and magnitude. It would be some sort of current or something like that as a function of time. The main problem is with this type of a definition or simulation is there are two numbers or more than two numbers, and that means we can't just give a nice single number answer and so forth. There's something really interesting that is about dynamic stability that it comes from control theory. So if we take the plot of our butterfly curves, and let's say this is Q and this is Q bar, and we have our nice butterfly curves over here, and we have our stable points over here and our metastable point over there. So we know what happens when, you know, Q equals zero and QB equals VDD. That's this is Q equals zero and QB equals VDD. And we know what happens when Q equals VDD and QB equals zero. But what happens when it's something else? Okay, let's say here it would be Q equals QB equals VDD over 2, even though it's not accurate VDD over 2. But let's say that that's the point of the separatrix, where, as we saw, we have this hill, and maybe we're stuck on a hill or something like that. What happens if all of a sudden we have this noise source that comes in and it throws, you know, us away? We get that delta V that we saw when we were doing a read, and all of a sudden our state is over here. Q equals this value and QB equals this value. What's going to happen after this thing that caused us to move over to this state goes away? So we can guess, I think all of us would guess that very quickly because of our situation, it's as if we had the ball over here, we brought it up over to here, and the ball's going to fall back down. So we're going to go back over into our stable state over here. But what if our noise source is so big that, for example, it throws us over to here? That could be similar to something like bringing our ball over to here, and now we're going to flip the cell. And that's a real big problem. So our state would flip over to here. And how do we know exactly what's going to happen to the cell? Well, it seems that in control theory, there is something called a separatrix. Okay, separatrix from separate, separatrix. Okay, it separates the space into two. And the separatrix is a line, and it does not have to be a straight line. In fact, it probably is not a straight line in a real condition. That it's kind of like a water, like when you have water that goes from one side of a hill down to one street, to one ocean, and on the other side to the other ocean. So this separatrix is this line where everything on this side will fall and arrive at this stable state, and everything on this side will fall and arrive at this stable state. And the separatrix, one thing we can see about it, it's going to pass through the metastable point. In fact, if you somehow pull our state onto the separatrix, guess what? It's going to actually converge to the metastable point. So the separatrix is an interesting thing, and you can look in the references at the end of the lecture. To see some work on how to plot the separatrix and find out what it is. For example, if now I do a write operation, you know, if I open up my, let's change our color here for a second, okay? If I, for example, just give a quick pulse on my word line, right? I just give a quick pulse. Am I going to be successful to write or not? And what we'll see is there's a trajectory where the state goes over to here. And if I close my word line over there, I'm not going to be able to write the other value. If I kept it long enough that I passed over the separatrix, then I would successfully write my value. Same thing with a read. It could be that my read operation, you know, it's not infinite like we assumed with static with static noise margin. And maybe I closed my read word line over here and I went back and I didn't actually flip the cell. But whereas when I assumed a static situation, I brought my place over to here, and when I infinite time closed the word line, I would have flipped the cell. So dynamic noise margin is an important thing on that aspect. That was stability of SRAM, and now we'll see how we actually go over and calculate SNM.